आप सबको फिर से मैं आज स्वागत करता हूं इस स्पेशल वेबिनार सीरीज में। आज इस स्पेशल वेबिनार सीरीज में हमारे पास स्पेशल गेस्ट हैं जो गुजरात इकोसिस्टम्स को शुरू से ही मार्गदर्शन दे रहे हैं। ही हैज बीन ए गाइडिंग फोर्स। जब स्टूडेंट इनोवेशन और स्टार्टअप इकोसिस्टम की एक्टिविटी हमने चालू किया तब से ही हैज बीन कीनली लुकिंग एट अस व्हाट वी आर डूइंग एंड गाइडिंग एट दिस स्टेज। So in this series we have a special guest Padma Bhushan Sri Krish Gopalakrishnan, chairperson of Axler Venture and one of the illustrious founder of Infosys, co-founder of Infosys. He has been kind enough to attend our past conferences of students innovation and startup efforts under the leadership of education department, under the leadership of principal secretary Anshu Madam, honorable minister Chudasma sahab. And he has been actively engaging with all our stakeholders, not only to inspire, but also to guide how to have a very futuristic roadmap. So, sir, I welcome you on behalf of iHub, the entire student startup and innovation ecosystem. I welcome Anshu Madam, chairperson iHub and principal secretary education. She is the real lighthouse for the entire movement which we are doing at the ground level. I also welcome Nagarjan, sir, Commissioner of Higher Education and member of the board of iHub for joining this special webinar series. I welcome all university vice chancellors, authorities, and all startups across 30 plus incubators.
Hiran Mai.
I also welcome all of us who have been participating through various Chamber of Commerce, CII, PK Gujarat Chamber of Commerce. Having said that, I would like to request Nagarjan sir to formally introduce Chris to the audience.
Thank you, Hiranmay. It is indeed my pleasure to propose a welcome address to Chris Gopalakrishnan. He is a Padma Bhushan Infosys inspiration to a generation of entrepreneurs. Chris Gopalakrishnan is chairman of Axler Ventures, a company supporting and funding startups. He was a former executive vice chairman and former co-chairman of Infosys. And he is also one of the 7 founders. And he is elected as the president of India's Apex Industry Chamber, Confederation of Indian Industry, for the year 2013-14. And Shri Gopalakrishnan is the chairman of International Institute of Information Technology, Bangalore, and vice chairman of Board for Information Technology Education Standards, set up by the government of Karnataka. Shri Gopalakrishnan has contributed ₹225 crores to develop a center for brain research at the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. He is the donor of the largest philanthropic gift ever received by the 105-year-old institute from an individual. He has contributed an additional ₹60 crores to set up distinguished visiting chairs in neurocomputing and data science at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, and Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, at Chennai. In 2011, Government of India awarded him with Padma Bhushan, which is India's third highest civilian honor. So I am so glad to have you, sir, today to address our principals, change makers and mentors for all the startups in the ecosystem, and also to the address the innovators and startups under the student startup and innovation policy, which is focused on increasing the pipeline of innovation in this state of Gujarat. I also take the opportunity to welcome our respected principal secretary education department, Srimati Anju Sharma. Over to you, sir, for your address for today. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much. So, Srimati Anju Sharma ji, Sri Nagarajan, Hiranmai, my friend, to the students, the faculty, the entrepreneurs of Gujarat and around the country, thank you for giving me this opportunity to interact with you today. You know, sometimes there is a silver lining in all, you know, crisis or challenging times that you face. You know, we adopted technology at a fast pace, and today most such interactions, conferences, seminars have gone online. And once you go online, you are able to connect with a large number of people, even larger than what you can do physically. Location is not a disadvantage. Location if you have access to digital technology, digital communication, location is not a disadvantage. And all of you don't have to travel or commute, right? So that is also a saving. So as I said, you know, there are you know, opportunities that exist. There are silver lining in every challenging time. And it's how you approach that that makes the difference. So I will talk about what I see as opportunities, and then we will have an interactive session. So I will try and restrict my presentation to maybe 35 to 40 minutes. And after that, we can have interactions. So first thing I want to tell you is that, you know, it's not the most intellectual of the species that survives. It's not the strongest that survives. It's not the one that has the, you know, the best resources. But the species that survives is the one that's able to adapt and adjust to the changing environment in which it finds itself. You know, this is the theory of evolution, right? One that is able to adapt to the changing environment. And I've seen this in my own life, actually. There have been twists and turns, and life is always full of twists and turns. You know, it's not that you're going to get everything that you hope for. There will be twists and turns. And so, for example, in my case, after my SSLC, that is 10th, I actually wanted to study for becoming a doctor. I didn't get admission. I missed getting admission by about 2 marks or something. And then I switched over to physics because I thought now that I cannot become a doctor, I will probably try and become a teacher or a professor. And I liked physics in those days. And while doing my MSc physics at IIT Madras, I got introduced to computers. So I switched my career to computers, joined a smaller company rather than a large company at that point. That's where all the founders of Infosys met, and rest is history, and I'm in front of you, right? So life is full of twists and turns, and you have to kind of go with the flow and take opportunities that are provided in front of you. And I will, you know, come back to this throughout the presentation. But before I start on that very quickly, now this is a pandemic, this is a crisis that none of us actually wanted, none of us expected, unfortunately. We were ill prepared, but we are now learning to cope with this. We are trying to figure out how we can live with the virus. Now we have to live with the virus because the virus is going to stay around for some time. So we need to think about safety of self, family, and colleagues. And it's your own responsibility to ensure that people around you are safe, which means that you have to wear the mask, you have to practice social distancing, you have to practice, you know, sanitation, hygiene, and things like that. This is as much to protect yourself as much as to protect the people around you. So it is your responsibility. Act responsibly with self-discipline. And if you do that, we can keep the spreading to the lowest possible level. If everybody wears masks, practice all these things, you know, this is not something that we need to worry about too much. Similarly, update your skills. Period of extreme uncertainty. This is a once in a lifetime phenomenon. No, none of the people alive probably have experienced anything like this. And so we are learning as we go along. Even though we have advanced so much in the last 100 years, we still are learning a lot about how to combat this virus. So I'm going to talk about, you know, what I suggest as an advice if you're passing out now, if you're passing out next year or beyond. And then I will focus on the startup side. You know, if you're thinking of doing a startup, if you already are a, you know, founder of a startup, and then I will conclude with comments about future. So if you're passing out now, See, during the crisis, you know, as you must have already realized, jobs are very difficult to come by. You know, recruitment in campuses have already happened because recruitment happens typically October, November, you know, the previous year, right? So offers have been made. Many of you have offers, but unfortunately, you know, nothing to do with you, nothing even to do with the companies that have recruited you. They will probably delay. Some may even be unable to honor the offers because they're in serious trouble. So this is a challenging period for all of you. And so my first advice is if you can continue studies, please do so, because you can then delay the time you're looking for a job. It's very difficult period, and that's one of the things that you can do actually. But if you already placed and you need to join, because you may not have any option but to take on a job right now, my suggestion is to update your skills based on who your employer is. Wait for the joining date and things like that, and have a plan B, because it is possible that that offer may not come through. You know, the company may not be in business, and they may actually not honor the offer, you know, unfortunately. But so you must have a plan B in place, so that there is an alternative. Now, if you are going abroad to study, again, travel is not allowed now. So some of these colleges may start their courses online, track how they are going to start the classes, track how they are going to begin, and figure out when you can travel, when visas will be issued and things like that. So if you're passing out now, on the positive side, most likely your offers are going to be honored. And there will be a delay, but your offers are going to be honored and you will be able to join them. If you're not able to join, have a plan B. If you're going abroad, think about how and when you will travel. Now, if you're not passing out this year, if you're passing out next year or beyond, you know, please find out which businesses are fast growing in the area that you have chosen and track these. For future employment. Why I say this is, you will find later in a presentation, every single sector is going to be transformed in the near future. Every single sector, you know, how we travel, mobility, how healthcare is going to be provided, hospitality, every sector that you can think of is changing. Education, retail, e-commerce. So you can actually track these changes and figure out which are the fast growing companies, because that's where you will get maximum opportunities. Fast growing companies which are going to provide the maximum opportunities. They may be startups, they may be established companies, but find those companies actually and find a way to ride on. If you're choosing a major or a minor, if you're in this beginning of this process of education, college education, find a wave to ride on. And there are many, many waves. See, I'm a product of the digital computer revolution. You know, the wave we rode on is the digital computing wave. But today there are many other waves that you can actually choose. In the area that, or in the location that you are studying, please find a NGO to volunteer with. The reason I say this is, this actually rounds off your skills, gives you opportunity to become a leader, gives an opportunity to solve problems that are relevant to society, etc. And it actually gives you specific skills that companies are looking for in terms of project management, problem solving, communication skills, getting to know what are the real problems societies are faced with, etc. Intern with startups in the field chosen. Again, you know, fast growing, right? So you actually can experience how a startup works, what is involved in working with a startup, is it something that you want? Because, you know, startups are, you know, a high pressure cooker environment actually. And sometimes people may actually opt to work for a larger company, more relaxed, etc. So, you know, experience what working with a startup looks like before you actually jump into it later on. So you have actually a lot more options, but you can actually be smart in preparing yourself for the future. That's what I meant here. So now let me come to, if you are a startup co-founder, if you've already done a startup and you know, this crisis has hit you, and in the crisis you will find that sometimes your customers are not buying, your revenues are disappearing, you are unable to deliver because lockdown and things like that. So there are lots of challenges businesses are facing in the lockdown, which is one of the longest in the world. For about 60 plus days we were under lockdown, right? And with no revenues, etc. So first thing to do is to make sure that you have enough cash to run the business for the next 24 days. That's the ideal scenario. Very few startups have that kind of luxury, but ideally you should have runway for the next 24 months. Review and cut all unnecessary and discretionary expenses such that you extend the runway to the maximum possible number of months. It's to help you survive this difficult time. We do not know how many months this is going to be a challenge, and hence I said 24 months, right? Because it's still uncertain how this is all going to play out. Get closer to your customers and improve customer service. So if you are paying customers, make sure that you serve them very well. They become references. They actually help you find new customers. They talk about your services, products. They become references, etc. When I look back at Infosys times in 2008, when the financial crisis struck, one of the most important things that we did at that time was to ensure that we served our customers very well. And every one of those customers became loyal customers, and they increased their business with Infosys during the downturn, or as soon as they were out of the crisis, they increased their business with Infosys. So you have to get closer to your customers. The closer you are to the customer, you may be able to also find out other things that you can support with the clients, other solutions that you can offer, which will give you immediate revenue and things like that. And you should have always a plan B, which means that, let's say you don't have runway for 24 months, seek support from your current investors, actually, because the current investors that you have a vested interest in making sure that you survive, because your investment is, their investment is with you, right? So they want to make sure that you survive. And so if you need some more money, these are the people who will provide that cash to you. They will support you during this downturn, provided they are confident that you survive. One of the ways in which you survive is to extend the runway, pivot and get current revenues, which I talked about already. Look for mergers and acquisitions. If you have enough cash, you can actually acquire companies and grow faster during this time. If you don't have, rather than shutting down the business, maybe you can actually get acquired, and at least the product and the solution will survive, your customers will survive, your employees will find a home to continue to work and things like that. If you don't have investors, if you've just started, don't have customers, put the idea in cold storage and restart later when times are better. Now, how does startups grow? This and the next slide I put in here because I feel that our model of how startups are created, how they grow, etc., require some rethinking, require some reality check, actually. So typically we identify a niche based on our capabilities, our skills, our strengths and things like that. We find a market segment that is underserved. We have a technology, we have a product that we feel will provide a solution. That solution may be quite location dependent. So for example, you know, you may start by saying that, you know, in Vadodara, it's underserved. I can actually start a business, let's say, delivering food to home, or looking at you know, education for kids, because nobody else is serving there, and you know, unique requirements maybe in Gujarati and things like that. So you find a niche and you start with that niche. Of course, you need to have a founding team, and every startup must actually understand the process of evolution of a startup. See, everything, and there are people who are doing MBAs in this interaction, and they will know that you know, everything has a systematic process. That's what MBA trains you to understand and learn and learn and use, actually. So similarly, the startup evolution has a process, has steps, you know, things that you need to do. So for example, you know, the after the founding team, you need to create a minimum viable product. You have to do customer validation. You have to do market validation. You have to create a business plan. And every one of those will have steps that you need to do. Get a mentor, get help, get support, join an incubator. Most of the universities today have incubators, or there are incubators in your city, etc. The advantage of being part of an incubator is that support mechanism, support system is already there. The ecosystem is already there. Government is there to help you. Funding becomes easier, etc. So join an incubator, get help, get mentors, etc. And create a profitable small business with minimum external funding. This is very important, because your goal at the beginning must be to establish a profitable business. Once you're profitable, it gives you actually a lot of options. So you can actually stay small, profitable. You don't need any more funding. You employ few people. You serve few customers. You are a viable business, and that's good. You know, you don't have any other boss, that you are your own boss and things like that, and providing a solution that society needs. And once you do this, then you look around. You figure out that this is something which probably the entire Gujarat requires, or the entire country requires now. There is very little competition, or you feel that you have a superior product compared to the competition. You have certain know-how, you have certain capabilities, you have certain advantage which you can actually defend and scale up. And that's when you look at investor interest. You look for more external funding so that you can scale. Investors are also looking for ideas that have been proven in the small, you know, in a small area where you can actually dominate, and then you plan to scale up and things like that. See, the advantage of doing this way, you know, this process, is that it gives you option to stay small and profitable. You only scale up if the opportunity exists to create a unique, viable startup. So let me now tell you. See, there are segments which are winner-take-all market segments. And in these segments, there are typically 3-4 players you'll end up with. So look at our telecom market itself, right? We have 3 major private players and 1 government public sector undertaking, BSNL, and we have Jio, Airtel, and Vodafone, right? If you look at, for example, search, it's primarily Google. If you look at social media, it's Twitter and Facebook, right? Globally, actually, there are only 2-3 players and things like that. These are what are called winner-take-all market segments. If you look at, for example, in India, in e-commerce, it's primarily Flipkart and Amazon, etc. Now, in these segments, if you want to enter, you have to be a niche player, because only niches will survive. Your market share will be small, but if you are profitable, you don't need to worry. You can continue to provide that. It's when you start competing with the larger players become a one solution to all. You know, you want to serve everybody. That's when you start competing with these larger players, these market leaders, etc. And you may actually lose momentum, run out of cash, investors will not fund growth, etc. And I'm trying to tell you that all startups need not scale up. Okay, if you want to scale up, you must be able to, from a niche player, become a market leader. If you are unable to make that transition, and that transition is very, very difficult, very painful, and you will run out of cash most times, and that's where the largest number of failures happen. So if you stay small and profitable, actually you will succeed, you will do well, you will actually provide employment, and you will be a good corporate citizen. And a lot of companies are SMEs. If you Anju Sharmaji knows this very well, or Nagarajan will tell you that 70% of the employment is created by the SME sector in India. That's a very, very important sector for the country. We want large number of SMEs. We want SMEs that are very well-run businesses. And so there is nothing wrong in becoming a small or medium enterprise, and you can actually serve a market segment with your unique services. And so this is a very important message for all the startups that are there listening to this. Now I'll switch to the last part of my presentation, which is to do with the future, my comments about the future. See, future is not a linear extrapolation of the past. The future is creating with past experiences, but it gets impacted. It gets changed, transformed by the innovations and the inventions that are happening in the current circumstances. So the COVID virus itself, COVID-19 virus itself, is going to impact our future, because that's a complete disruption of society as we know today. Many things are going to change. So for example, faster adoption of digital. You know, it's a change that is going to happen. An accelerated shift to online education, a shift to telemedicine and teleconsulting. Now, these are all changes that are going to happen. And, you know, in February, if you think about these things, you wouldn't have realized this. It's being forced on us by this crisis. Similarly, when mobile telephone was introduced, right, we leveraged that to use mobile telephone for most of our financial transactions and services. Today, all consumption of video is onto a mobile device, right, on a tablet or a mobile phone, and it's asynchronous. So we no longer are tied to the timing of when the broadcast happens. We view it when we want to view the content. So addition or removal of constraints influence the future. Leaders and entrepreneurs make transformation indeed happen. And what we are looking for, each one of you, is to actually lead in this transformation, be the entrepreneur that changes an industry, and new leadership emerges. So the top five companies by market cap in the US are all companies less than 50 years old. And some of them, so for example, Google was in 1997, 23 years old. Facebook was 2007. Amazon was 1994. So three of the top five companies in the world by market cap, in US by market cap, are all 25 or 26 years old, actually. So why did this happen? Internet came, mobile telephone came, social networking came, cloud computing came, and all of that created new opportunities for how business is conducted. Amazon, for example, completely changed e-commerce, right? Social networking is a completely new business itself. So those opportunities arise when new technologies are introduced. And I will talk about what new technologies are coming. So we are always looking for a faster, better, cheaper way of doing things using better tools and technology. And that's what you must focus on when you try to create a solution in area that you have chosen. Now, I will give you an example from the IT services industry. So 1981 was when the personal computer was introduced. It allowed everybody to buy a computer. You know, affordability came down. You know, everybody could afford to buy a computer. In offices, every desk had a computer, and all business processes got transformed to using a computer. You know, you use the computers to enter sales orders. You use the computer to invoice and things like that. Previously, they were all done manually using paper and pen and things like that. So business processes were automated using computers and software, and large amount of software was to be written. So what we did at Infosys was that we said, let's develop this software for the world sitting in India, leveraging the lower cost economy due to lower cost of living. It's not that we're cheaper because we want to be cheap. It's cheaper because it costs much less in India to develop software and things like that. And we have huge number of people, you know, abundant talent available in India. That still is true. We are the second largest professional workforce in the world, and our workforce is technology enabled, actually. And that's how we created the successful IT services business out of India. These companies today are in the top 10. Five out of our Indian companies are in the top 10 in the world. We have created $190 billion of business, all because of these simple principles. You know, we rode on this digital computing wave. We saw the demand for software. We knew that we could develop this at a lower cost sitting in India. When we started, telecommunication links were not available. The telecommunication links were established in the 90s, actually. But we were prepared. We were ready. When Infosys was started, we used to courier software on a tape to the US. We will then go there, install, etc. Today, sitting at anywhere. So now, with work from home, we can sit at home and actually work on these programs and things like that. We can do business process management. We can do all kinds of services sitting at wherever we are. And that is what we created. That's the industry that we created. And that's the opportunity. This is how future is created out of new opportunities that arise. So I talked about the innovations that are coming. Computers, smartphones, etc. are already there. Telecom infrastructure, cloud computing. But look at what are the new things that are coming. And I've only listed a very few here. There's a long list of things that are coming. IoT devices, which will change all physical things, actually. Every physical thing that you want to be managing, you want to control, can actually be enabled through computing, can be managed digitally. We can connect life forms, actually. We can create new life forms in the lab. Using AI and ML, we can actually handle large amount of data and make inferences out of that data, create action plans and things like that, execute on those actions. 3D printing will change manufacturing. So lots and lots of innovations are coming. And this is what is going to transform every industry that we can think of. And I'll talk about it in the next few slides, actually. So this is actually a golden period. And this was there before the COVID situation, and this will be there after the COVID situation. We have just taken a pause. That's all. So the opportunity exists before, existed before, and will exist after also. It exists today also. So every industry will get impacted, and startups will emerge with new business models and solutions. And you know all these things, right? How Airbnb, our own Oyo rooms, actually changed the hotel industry, hospitality industry. How Oyo changed the taxi in the Uber and things like changed the taxi industry, and Amazon, Flipkart changed the e-commerce retail segment. You know, every industry will get transformed. And when industries get transformed, new leadership will emerge. Some large companies will fail and new companies will come to take care of that. So if you look at healthcare, with IoT, connected devices, telemedicine, genomics, robotic surgery, you know, I see healthcare completely getting transformed. If you look at the COVID situation itself, it's the older people with comorbidities who got affected more, right? And hence there will be focus on preventive care. There'll be focus on taking care of the older population better so that they have higher immunity and things like that. So media and entertainment, you know, again, I talked about how content is actually getting streamed onto personal devices and things like that. It's interactive. We watch now movies sitting in different places, but together, sharing our experiences through messages, chat, and things like that. Now you'll have a chat window and you'll be chatting while you're watching something, just as if you're doing this physically together. So all these experiences are being created, and this seminar itself, right? You're going to ask me questions on the chat or the question answer box and things like that. So all of these are actually new way of doing things that used to happen physically. And you will see this happening everywhere. Even thinking like, you know, thinking about restaurants, right? One of the interesting things I saw was, you know, because restaurants were closed, the chef actually started doing online classes. His menu and things like that. Then they started offering ingredients and home delivery. So you can either get cooked food or ingredients so that you can actually do the course along with the cook or the chef at sitting at home. And they created a new business out of the downturn and things like that. So all kinds of things are possible. It's just left to your imagination, your creativity, your ability to innovate and doing these things differently. I'm actually very optimistic about something that's an emerging area, what I call data business, because we are producing huge amount of data. So there is opportunity in cleaning and labeling data. What I mean by this is, in order to train these AI and ML systems, we need to label and tag this data. So for example, if you have a huge number of photographs and you want to actually train the system to recognize cats, somebody has to sit down and say, this is a picture of a cat, this is not a picture of a cat, things like that, right? So you have to identify all cat pictures, cats, you know, photographed from different angles and things like that, so that when the system is trained, it will start recognizing cats. And that system will only recognize cats because that's been trained with data about cats and things like that. The silly example looks like, but that's really how we train systems, etc. So curated data is required, and there's a huge, huge opportunity. Curated data is required to ensure that social media platforms are compliant. Governments are becoming a lot more rigid in terms of, you know, fake news and wrongful content being delivered using social media and things like that. We need to create data warehouses for certain applications, research applications, etc. So more and more in the future, for example, in pharma field, the trials will be done digitally first using computers, and later on the trials will happen with physical subjects and things like that. So for that, we require to create huge amount of data and things like that, you know, genomics data or longitudinal data about patients and things like that. And finally, the objective of creating a data business is to create intelligence from this data and sense and respond automatically. You know, if you think about a self-driving vehicle, driverless car, it's actually sensing and responding, right? It's driving by itself. So those kind of systems are the future. But it requires, you know, that example, for example, It requires huge amount of data to say, okay, you know, if you take a picture of the surrounding, you know, these are all people. These are all lampposts and cycles and other cars. These are all road signs. This is a traffic signal. You know, you have to train the system to recognize all these things, and then you can actually figure out how to make a driverless car and driverless vehicle and things like that. So that's what data business is all about. And that's a new opportunity, a completely new field, new opportunity, new jobs are going to be created. Large number of jobs are going to be created in this area. India opportunity. I feel that we are in the best place. Honestly, I feel we are in the best place. 1.3 to 1.4 billion people. Today, of course, very low per capita income, but there are 300 million people, 30 crore people at least, who are considered middle class. When I say middle class, they can afford to buy an apartment, they can afford to buy a vehicle, they can send their children to school, and they can afford reasonable luxuries in life and things like that. But in the next 20 years, let us say, we will go from a $2.7 trillion economy to $5 trillion to $10 trillion. Imagine that. Four times the wealth that exists today, or the GDP size grows by four times. That's a huge, huge opportunity. And this is the reason why the entire world is coming to India to take advantage of our consumer base, to invest in companies in India, etc. This is a consumer base that's connected by smartphones and ubiquitous connectivity, because they're all connected. Our telecom infrastructure is one of the best in the world at lowest price points, etc. More and more, we are seeing that all the appliances we buy, you know, microwave ovens or coffee machines or refrigerators or computers and everything, lights, and you know, everything is getting enabled through IoT devices connected to computers and things like that. We are already starting to use AI ML without even realizing that we are using AI ML. So, for example, if you're using Alexa or Siri or something like that, at the back end, it's actually an AI ML engine running to understand you know, the voice and make intelligence out of that. You know, we have actually demonstrated this. Suddenly we created 80 crore bank accounts, right? And that's through mobile telephony, digital inclusion and things like that. We have the third largest startup ecosystem. You know, we have 36 unicorns. Maybe some of them are hurt because of this downturn, but given that this will end sometime soon, I'm confident in saying that we will revive our startup ecosystem. We will have more unicorns in the future. We have experienced entrepreneurs and mentors. I strongly feel that India is the best place to test new solutions and models, because we are a developing country. Now, if you're developed, so for example, India has 3% of its people, or maybe 4% of its people, owning cars. That means 96% of the people don't have cars. In the US, the ownership is actually 1.2 or 1.3. That for every person, there's 1.2 or 1.3 cars. So when you want to sell cars, which is the market that's best for you? India, right? Large consumer base, penetration is very low. Penetration of e-commerce and online retail is about 10% in India. Again, you know, huge opportunity to scale up and things like that. And government is very supportive of innovation, startups, etc. There are multitude of schemes to support startups, etc. And I believe that this is the best time. If you want to do this, if you want to take employment, go ahead and do that. Startup is not for everyone. And every startup should not think about scaling. I think that's, again, another important message that I need to tell you. So this is a difficult time, but I feel that this will go away. Utilize this time as best you can to prepare yourself to the time when this is going to get over sooner than later. Make sure that you're prepared to face the challenges the world is going to throw at you, and there will be large number of opportunities because of the market, because of the innovations that are coming, emerging technologies that are coming. Every industry is going to be transformed. So I am very optimistic about the future, and the future will provide significant opportunities. And I'm going to end with a quote from Steve Jobs, one person I admire a lot, which says that, when you grow up, you tend to get told that the world is the way it is, and your life is just to live your life inside the world. They tell you not to bash into the walls too much, not to change things, have a nice family, have fun, save little money, but that's a very limited life. Life can be much broader once you discover one simple fact. Everything around you that you call life was made by people that were no smarter than you. And you can change it, you can influence it. Once you learn that, you will never be the same again. And I'm going to, with taking little liberty, I'm going to take Anju Sharma ji as an example. In government, there are bureaucrats, the bureaucrats that act, that want to make a change, that will go outside their call of duty. Yesterday in the education department, handling startups, entrepreneurship and things like that. Kiran Mai ji, completely taken the responsibility to start entrepreneurship in Gujarat, and has touched hundreds and thousands of students. You can make a difference. And I can tell you that I was also very much similar, ordinary person, middle class or lower middle class. It was just determination, hard work, a lot of luck, but you can actually make a difference. And that's what I would want every one of you to think about and do. Hiranmay, over to you to start the question and answer session. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. So we have pulled in a lot of questions. We have more than 3,000
participants.
So I'll pick three questions. And Nagarjan, sir, you have more questions at the desk.
Yeah, I have a few things already lined up. In fact, one starts with what government can do with the startup. What Mr. Vikram has asked it on the Q&A section. So the question is whether government policies can actually help in becoming help in supporting entrepreneurs, or is it better to leave them alone? What do you think about this? I think it's a very pertinent question today that needs to be answered.
I strongly believe that it is together that we can make a difference. Government has an important role in creating the right policy framework. We will have lots of regulations, lot of legacy regulations, etc. And as you all know, there are 100 ways you can stop something from happening, right? But there is only one way you can make something happen. That's because you have a desire to make that happen. Then you will find actually a way to do these things. So I strongly feel that government has an important role to play in ease of doing business, creating the right environment, the right policy framework, being industry friendly and things like that. I can tell you that in the 1980s, late 80s actually, Government of India came with one simple concept called Software Technology Park. It's the best single window clearance system India has ever invented. Okay. Before that, everything required us to go to Delhi to get approval. Multiple ministries had to approve things. Under Software Technology Park, even the building permissions, the plan approval was done by STP. Single window clearance for everything that you can think of. They were actually acting as our customs approval people. You can import something with STP clearance. Our exports were certified by STP. We didn't have to go to Delhi because STPs were set up around the country. Government can do it. And I feel that the IT industry's growth is is because of reforms like this, and they also put very good officials in charge of the STP and things like that. So yes, I strongly believe that government has a play important role to play. Government also creating various grant schemes, funds, fund of fund schemes. So there are many things that government can do and should do to help and support the entrepreneurs. See, ultimately, what does the government want? You know, government wants jobs to be created, economic growth to happen, wealth to be created for its citizens, and innovations to be brought to market, etc. And that's all startups are doing. So you can work together and create these things.
Thank you, sir. I think one of the biggest impact of the student startup innovation policy is that it has created an enabling environment. And before this policy, the word student and startup were never in the same line. Today, now they are together. So I think that kind of enabling environment could be provided by a policy, and which has thinking and imagination of a student. So that is a very visible example. I can also think relating from what you have shared. Sir, you have done a lot of efforts in startup, especially in the young age entrepreneurs in startup in Kerala. So could you share some ideas and learnings from that, and some of things that we could also, you know, cross apply in Gujarat?
So, you know, you have already doing that. See, the first implementation of student startup policy was really in Kerala, where they said that in engineering courses, you can start a business and it'll be considered as part of the curriculum. You will be given credits for doing a startup, and you will actually get evaluated on how you run the startup and things like that. And Gujarat has taken that very nicely, implemented it, and what you see today is the result of that. When you are a student, you know, you can actually fail safely without actually impacting anybody else. It's part of your studies, and that's the best way to learn, right? Running a business is the best way to learn a business. So, you know, it's the right thing to do. In Kerala, the other thing they have done very well is created they have created a lab for hardware startups, hands-on lab. I forget the exact name for that.
Like a makerspace.
Makerspace, exactly. So yes, they have created a makerspace. If you've not done that, I think you need to do makerspaces in different industries. So one for maybe auto industry, another for healthcare, a third one for because healthcare will require a lot of IoT devices and things like that. You know, a third one for maybe because Gujarat is famous for textiles and things like that, garment industry. If you do that, you will actually encourage a lot of innovations to happen in these industries.
Thank you, sir. And since you are now leading the Axler Ventures, you have invested in many startups, especially which are having young entrepreneurs in their teams. So what is your observation about the upcoming generation of entrepreneurs, and what is the qualities that you find now with them?
See, they are not afraid. They're very confident. They feel that they can conquer the world. And I'm actually inspired by many of the founders that I've meet today, and that's why I'm enjoying what I'm doing. I feel that they have a lot more opportunities, they have a lot more revenues, the support system is mature, funding is available, so they're in a much, you know, they're much better placed to take advantage of these and create large number of very impactful companies. See, Infosys took 23 years to hit $1 billion, 23 years. And a Flipkart did it in less than 10 years, right? So you are seeing acceleration today. 36 unicorns in the last 3-4 years. So you are seeing accelerations, and today's entrepreneurs are definitely delivering on the potential.
Yeah. So I'll just take one question from Facebook feed. Dr. Anubhav Rai is asking from Alwar, Rajasthan. And the question is, sir, you talked about creating future from past experiences, integrating with innovations and allied things. What was could be the one thing which can be called as the common thread which brought you and other six co-founders together and to build Infosys way back in 1981.
So, see, our past experiences were about doing something in India and out of India. You know, we were, even in those days, very much wedded to the idea of leveraging the talent that's available in India. We were very confident. We are product of that ecosystem, that environment. And we felt that, you know, it would be actually much more rewarding to create a world-class company out of India. It will change the perception about India. It will change the perception about professionals from India. And that's what we wanted to do. We felt that a huge amount of software needed to be created. And that's what we tried to do. You know, past experience. So for example, if you look at healthcare today, you know that we lack the number of beds that are required, number of hospitals that are required, number of specialists that are required. We're not able to provide quality healthcare in remote areas, etc. So you know that experience is there with you. You probably have experienced this, you know, maybe from a tier two city or a tier three city, you found it how difficult it is to get quality healthcare. Now, can you leverage that? But that's an experience with somebody else who's actually not experienced that will not feel. You can read it in a paper or you read it in a book, but unless you have that experience, you will not appreciate how much of a challenge this is. And then if you come out with a solution, you will actually properly address these problems rather than use textbook knowledge to address these solutions. That's what I mean by that. You are conditioned by past experiences, then you find an innovation or a technology that allows you to provide a different solution. And that's what you want to do.
Wonderful, sir. Sir, one question I will take from Dean of Indus University. And he says that the point that you talked about, scale is not an imperative parameter necessarily for being a successful startup. You can still be successful by making impact by being small and having a good unit economics. So how do you really know whether you should stay at certain degree and do profitable things at a small, or you can really go a step ahead in scale? So how do you really draw that gray line?
See, I define success as one, if you create jobs for five people, for example, right? If you run business legally, ethically, if you pay your taxes, you know, from your profit, you pay taxes, right? So the state also benefits from being a successful company, right? So you must define success in simple parameters. Longevity, for example, to me is a measure of success. You know, if you are able to give jobs for the next 30 years, you know, then I define that as a success. So if you define success based on these parameters, you will find that a lot more businesses qualify to become successful businesses. In a society, you will have large number of small and medium enterprises and very few large enterprises. In the winner-take-all space, there will be only probably 3-4 successful global dominating companies in a segment. It doesn't mean that all others are failures. All others are providing niche services, and that's what we want, actually. You know, somebody probably doing e-commerce for artisans in the Kutch area, right? You know, Amazon may do it, but it gets lost in the millions of products that Amazon has. It's very difficult to find a product from Kutch. You know, nobody will come to Amazon looking for a product from Kutch. But if there is a niche e-commerce venture which represents the artisans from Kutch, people will know about it and will come to that place, right? So that's what I mean by saying that you can actually stay small, provide a wonderful solution, a useful solution, impactful solution, and create jobs, create livelihood, and things like that.
Thank you, sir. Sir, you have been also the former president of the largest industry chamber of this country, Confederation of Indian Industries. What do you think that industries will be playing role enabling further our student startup and innovation ecosystem?
So CII has a startup council. I chair the startup council of CII. What we do is, one, we work with state governments and central governments to set the right policy for encouraging startups. We share best practices between governments. Now, if something has been done well in Gujarat, can I take to now Bihar or let's say Assam or somewhere else? We connect these different ecosystems, etc. Second, we disseminate knowledge. You know, you will see that just now we published the second edition of the startup manual, and it's now available on the ebook version is available on Amazon already. That's a venture of CII actually. Third is we work with incubators and accelerators. We want to network them, share best practices. We want to actually create space in the incubator for our startups to find temporary space and things like that. You know, we want to work with these incubators. We want to work with state-run incubators, etc., to encourage them to become better at supporting. So there are many things that we want to do as CII to support startups.
Wonderful.
One last thing I want to say this. We are also canvassing family offices and high net worth individuals to invest in the startup ecosystem. You know, unfortunately, when you go beyond CDC funding, most of the funding comes from outside the country. In fact, 95% of the funding beyond CDC is overseas money. It's not that we don't have money in India. It's just that our money is not chasing startups. Right, so we are actually working with high net worth individuals and family offices to invest in the startup ecosystem in India.
One student from Kutch is asking you, like you mentioned that you had a dream of becoming a doctor, you failed to become a doctor, but you still made Infosys. So he says that, sir, you made my day. Even if you fail, you can still become bigger and make more impact. So one halt is not end of progress. And he says that, is there a scope of students like us being in rural areas, 500 kilometers away from capital, also have equal scope to access resources to be an emerging startup and do something in this country?
I strongly believe so. I came from Trivandrum, born and brought up in Trivandrum, not in one of the metros that you know or think about. And hard work, like, you know, I could do the things that I did, and I strongly believe that with hard work, with will, with some imagination and creativity, you can do it. Find a problem in your ecosystem, your environment. Find a technology-based solution to solve that. Do it well, and then you figure out whether that solution can be scaled up to the entire state of Gujarat or to the entire country or the entire world. And step by step, take it step by step actually. You know, first, provide a very good solution in the city, in the town, in the village that you are actually operating. And scale it slowly. That's how I would like to do this. And you can indeed do this. Today, see, you are able to access this interaction, this seminar, sitting where you are, right? So technology is going to remove all advantages of distance, all advantages of access, etc. You will be able to access all the knowledge in the world, all the technology in the world, all the funding that's available in the world, sitting wherever you are. Of course, basic things, you know, you need to work hard, you need to be creative, innovative, you need to communicate your idea. All of that remains the same, but that anybody can do. I don't believe that, you know, somebody in the city is better in doing these things than somebody in a village or something. Everybody is given certain capabilities, and they can maximize the use of those capabilities.
Wonderful. As you told, we have participation from 17 states in your webinar today. My team just sent me the analytics. One of the vice chancellor of Uttarakhand is saying, Chris, what would you see as the startup ecosystem growing? Is it more cities like Bangalore becoming hub of startups? or we will have every district, every taluka, every small places also taking part in this Arabian Awards?
See, definitely cities like Bangalore have advantage because of concentration of talent, concentration of companies, concentration of resources and things like that. Mentoring will be easier because you're used to physical mentoring and things like that. Having said that, that is going away. You know, once we get used to providing these digitally, providing these online, and more sessions like this, those advantages start disappearing. There is a challenge still about discovery, right? When you have a great solution, let's say in Vadodara or in Chhattisgarh, how do you get that known across the country? So this is where I feel that the incubators play a role, the academic institutions and the government plays a role, because you can organize an event and you invite, let's say, VCs from around the country, investors from around the country to come and look at these startups. Now, if it's done once a month, they will not mind coming. They can't come every day. So you can actually, by design, think about ways in which you can actually allow your startups to be discovered, allow your startup to reach out to resources that are available around the world. You know, I know of startups that are going from, you know, Kannur in Kerala I don't think many people in this seminar would know where Kannur in Kerala is actually. It's a hub of startups actually in Kerala, because one engineering college there decided to create an incubator and create support for startups and things like that. And there are startups going from there right straight to the Silicon Valley. They don't even come to Bangalore actually. They just straight going to the Silicon Valley. They have students going from Kannur to the valley for getting training and things like that. So this is possible today.
Wonderful. Sir, one participant is saying, how do you see role of social entrepreneurship in Indian startup ecosystem?
So you need, when I say entrepreneur, the broad definition of entrepreneur is somebody who works with limited resources, who works under constraints, who efficiently allocates those resources and solves societal problems. See, this is the generic definition of an entrepreneur to me. A problem solver working with limited resources and optimally using those resources. Better than the current usage of those resources. Now you bring more efficiency. So you have entrepreneurship possible in the social sector, in the NGO sector, social enterprise sector, and then standard, you know, normal business sense also. So entrepreneurship is necessary everywhere, including what are called intrapreneurs, entrepreneurs within enterprises. Because every enterprise has problems to be solved, new products to be created. And if you run these as small internal businesses, actually you will run it better.
Having said that, I would like to welcome Srimati Anju Sharma Madam, Principal Secretary Education. With her guidance, this policy took in place in last 4 years. The institutions like IHOV has emerged. I request Madam to share your remarks.
Good evening, Gopalakrishnan and Nagarajan, Hiranmay. We have been organizing these sessions, the eminent business people and the entrepreneurs, for the last 2 months now. And it's been a very successful and fulfilling experience. Today we have Chris Gopalakrishnan with us, who is a well-known name, and I don't need to introduce him to anybody. He has been associated with our startup journey since long, and we have always been having his support and cooperation in all our startup related activities. Gujarat government took on itself the task of developing startups in the state, especially to create a pipeline from amongst the students through the student startup and innovation policy. Initially, the task appeared very challenging to us. With the help of a very good team and with the help of our ecosystem, we could make a very successful dent. Some of the few achievements that I have to enumerate this, and I've always been telling this, that when we started this startup movement, at that time, people were not aware of what a startup is actually about. And most of the teaching and pedagogy, even in Western Institute, focused on the regular curriculum and examination pattern. So for the first time, students and the faculty members and the teachers and even the parents, they started thinking along the lines of startup and innovation. That is a very important component of the entire teaching journey and entire learning journey, I would say. As a result of which, even in the remotest of remote places in Gujarat now, they know what is a startup. They know what is innovation. They have a small incubator. They have small 3D machine. So these kind of things have been taking place, and they are all connected on the iHub platform. More than 16,000 students who are regularly participating in all these webinars, and the enthusiasm of these students is really, really intoxicating. And the high that it gives to you, to anyone, especially to me, like I would say, is it is beyond compare. And the energy that the youngsters have is amazing, and I can understand how people like you, even in this age, and you've been working with the youngsters all these years, and you've been mentoring them, guiding them through your own example, and also with the help of the other things, other knowledge of analysis and everything. I can understand what kind of satisfaction you would be getting through this, and personally, it has been a very fulfilling journey for me on this startup, and it is still continuing. And I don't find any reason why I would not be continuing this for rest of the years of my life. And if you see the industrial environment in the world has moved from various phases to the other, starting from something like 18th century, 19th century, where focus was on machine. Then the focus came early 20th century, focus came on systems. And then now, in the 21st century, the focus is, of course, on systems, but it's totally on technology. It's totally on virtual space. And in fact, right now, very recently, we have seen Elon Musk's space journey, SpaceX. It's the space around us that is really calling the shots now. And whether it's a virtual space or it is the space beyond Earth, astronomical space, or it is space between the people, it all boils down to space. So young entrepreneurs, they have done a lot of work, and they have helped a lot of collectors, district administrations, and their own projects also they're doing on their own to help people in COVID, making things easier for them, and also setting up systems which were not even thought of earlier. In fact, COVID-19 has brought to us a total disruption. We were talking of disruptive technologies. We were talking of thinking about disruption. There cannot be a bigger disruption than COVID-19. It disrupted virtually everything. It disrupted the way we looked at life. It disrupted what we considered our priorities. So everything got disrupted. And that brought us to now things like organizing webinars. Now, something like 3 months back, these kind of things were unimagined, unheard. And one could not even think that we will be holding 2 to 3 webinars every day and such large numbers. We were connecting to in any program we would invite 300, 400 students. Now at the go, we are connecting to thousands of students and we're getting the benefit of learning. And also taking this further, what I have done is that we are launching now platform for various kind of learning for startups, and we are starting a startup runway and iHubX, which we want to promote as a startup school, because among other things that we are doing as our flagship programs, we also have lakhs of students who just need a basic introduction to what the startup is all about, and they just don't know anything about that. So we have started these programs, and we've also started a process of engaging our entrepreneurs on in the virtual space on a daily, day-to-day basis, and we are working very fast on that. We have put a very good team now. We have, of course, Hiranmay was already there even when you came last. Mr. Nagarajan has joined us as Commissioner of Higher Education. Then there are certain others also in the team who have joined us. And we have a very robust team now that is working with us. Other than that, we also have our partners, and iHub being the bigger umbrella. We have the small incubators of the institutions with us. So we have GSEC, and we have the other incubators of PDPU, Ganpati University, and other incubators with whom we are working. We also have the chief mentorship of Dr. Himanshu Pandya, who has been himself a VC and has been very instrumental in bringing up GSEC. So he is also constantly advising and constantly guiding the iHub team to take up various initiatives. And so we put together a very robust and rather a very, very enthusiastic and vibrant team that is taking the whole thing forward. And it's always been a pleasure for me personally and for iHub to connect with you always. And as I've always been telling you that I have to come and visit you at Bangalore, and last time also when we spoke. So I have to come, and I hope that I'm not going to do virtually. I will do it only physically when I hope that is done fast, so that we can physically come there and we are out of this COVID. And we can have a good, we'll have dinner together and take the things forward with your support. Thank you so much for joining us. It's really been a great pleasure. Thank you.